Hi, welcome to software testing. This is the second video on module 1, that is introduction to software testing. So in this video, the following contents we are going to cover, that is basic definitions and as well as software quality, and third topic is test cases. How to write the test cases, what are all the informations are included in the test cases, and insight from a Venn diagram. So we are going to show the Venn diagram, so for the software testing, and how we will going to evaluate the errors and as well as requirement specification and as well as testing we'll going to cover. So these are the topics which we are going to learn from this video. So next, so the first topic is basic definitions of the software testing. What are all the basic definitions we required so for this software testing to learn? So the first topic is definition is error. What is the meaning of error? Error is nothing but it is a good synonym of a error is nothing but mistake. So when we will do the mistakes while we are coding, these are all we can call it as a bugs. So these errors will always tends to propagate. This is about the just basic idea or definition about the error. Means error is nothing but mistake. The human will do the mistake while coding. So those mistakes we can also call it as bugs. So these errors will always tends to propagate. So this is about the small definition of error, or we can also call it as mistake. The second definition or basic definition in the software testing is fault. So the fault we can also call it as the defect. So or else we can also call it as good synonym for a fault is defect. A fault is nothing but it is the result of an error is called a fault. Or one more word or one more definition we can define, like it is a representation or re-representation of an error is called a fault. So where representation is nothing but it's a mode of expression. So for example, such as narrative text or data flow diagrams or hierarchical chart or source code and so on, these are all we can call it as a representation or re-representation of an error. The error may occur during these any one of the expressions, like mode of expressions. When we are presenting, in that case the fault or defect can be identified very easily. So and a fault can be elusive. Elusive is also nothing but it is very difficult to find. So if we are executing a particular code or source code, so then if it is still faults are existed or defects are existed, so then if you are still executing that code, means then it is very difficult to identify that particular fault where it is existed. So this is about a small idea about the fault. So fault is nothing but it is the representation or re-representation of an error is called a fault. Or we can also define, so it is a result of an error, or fault is nothing but it is a result of an error is called a fault. It is very difficult to identify, so if it is existed in the code. Okay, so the representation is nothing but it is the mode of expression. The mode of expression might be a hierarchical chart or a source code or data flow diagrams. These are all we can call it as a representation of errors. Means how the errors may execute or else we are representing in the code. So there are basically two types of faults will occurs. One is fault of commission, and second one is fault of omission. The fault of commission is nothing but this will going to occur when we enter something into representation that is incorrect information. when we will represent an incorrect information, then we will call it as a fault of commission. For that we have to pay. So that is the meaning of that fault of commission. So in case if we, while writing the code itself, we will do the mistake either in the formula or else in the representation of any mathematical notations. So if we made a mistake, then so that kind of example I can call it as a fault of commission. For example, in the banking software, so whenever we want to calculate the rate of interest of either housing loan or FDs, okay, fixed deposits or saving accounts, in that case, if the formula in the coding part, if the formula itself we have done a mistake, then automatically what happens, it will go into represents or re-representation of an fault or errors will execute. Therefore, we can call it as this is the fault of commission. Means, so for that, the bank needs to be a pay for it. So whenever, so there is an faults or defects are existed in this, in the code. So therefore, when we are entering something, so into their representation that is incorrect information, then for that we have to pay. This therefore that situation we can call it as a fault of commission. So what is the meaning of fault of second type is we can call it as fault of omission. So that fault of omission will occurs when we fail to enter correct information of so these two types. For example, fault of omissions are more difficult to detect and as well as it is more difficult to resolve. So for it means when we will fail to enter correct information means sometimes when we are executing, so some of the piece of code we have left it out, means that part we have not at all coded, then we will call it as a fault of omission. Means that piece of code or else that particular logic is not at all existed or entered correct information into the coding. In that case, so that situation we can call it as a fault of omission. It is very difficult to detect and as well as resolve. Why? Because that particular logic or code does not exist in the back end. Then it is very difficult to identify for the tester. So why? Because that logic itself or a piece of code itself is not existed in the whole throughout code or information. So therefore, that kind of piece of code we can call it as a fault of omission. These are the basic two types of faults. One is fault of commission and second one is fault of omission. So whenever there is a designer will make an error, so that is of omission, the resulting fault is that something is missing that should be present in the representation itself only. Okay. So therefore, to identify that, we have categorized that mistake which has been done by the designer while writing the code. Might be he has left it out, then some set of piece of codes or else some logic he has not written for some functions. In that case, we can call it as a omission. Sometimes he has written, but that is totally wrong he has written. Then so for that also we have to pay it. So that we can call it as a fault of commission. Okay, these are the basic types of the fault and definition of the fault. Then, so the third basic definition of the software testing is failure. What is the meaning of failure? The failure is nothing but, so which will going to occurs when a fault will executes. Means, so whenever that piece of code does not return in the code itself only, or else some piece of code we have written, but it is wrongly we have written or incorrect format we have written. In that case, still also if you are trying to execute that code, then the failure will occurs. So that we can call it as a, so whenever the fault will executes, such a situation we can call it as a failure. So that is two subtle say are arises. For example, so failures only occurs when we are executable representation is there. Means when we are executing that particular code, which is usually taken to be a source code or loaded object code. So that object code or source code, so when it is in the form of executable representation, then only the failure can be occurred. Then second one is when this particular failure definition is there, it is related to only for fault of omission or sorry fault of commission means, so when we are going to test that particular code in the executable mode, only we will going to test for existing code. Means if he has anything has been done or wrong or incorrect information has been entered, so that can be identified very easily and that can be reported. So therefore fault of commission, during the fault of commission the failure can be identified, but in during the fault of omission, so this failure cannot be executed. Why? Because that piece of code or that particular part is not at all existed, therefore there is no any point to talk about the fault of omission. Okay, so that is about the definition of failure. Then the fourth basic definition is incident. What is the meaning of incident? The incident is nothing but, so when a failure is occurs, it may or may not be readily visible to the user. Okay, for example, when we will execute, then faults might be arises, but sometimes it is visible to the user, sometimes it may not be visible to the users, but back end it is failed. Okay, so while executing, so therefore, so we can also call it as an incident is nothing but it is a symptom which is associated with the failure that alerts the users for the occurrences of a failure. That is nothing but it will go into alert the users, so whenever the failure is occurs. Okay, so for example, so a test is for example, I can say that some set of or piece of code has been written, but whatever we are expecting, so with respect to the expected output result, if you are not getting, or else then some piece of code is or some function does not works properly, then it will going to alert. That is nothing but, so it is a symptom which is associated with the failure that will going to alerts the user to the occurrences of a failure. Means then the failure will occurs, then that will going to report it back to the designers. So this is what we can call it as a incident. Okay, this is the fourth definition of an basic definition of the software testing. Then so next definition of the software testing is test. What is mean, how we can define a test? A test is nothing but it is an act of exercising the software with the test cases. Means, so here what happens, the we want to check the particular project, or if we want to check that particular piece of code whether it works according to the end user requirement specification or not. Means, so how we will going to do, so we will going to test that code. So that is nothing but we are calling it as a, it is an act of exercising the software by specifying with the different test cases. For I'll give one best example. For example, let us consider if I am writing a code for a triangle problem. Okay, so to identify, so the whenever I will give the input for your code, then the code has to give the output result, so in a specified manner. For example, when the values are same, like input values of three sides of a triangle are same, then I need to get output result, it is an equilateral triangle. When two sides of a triangle is values are same, then the third side of a triangle is different, then I have to get output result isosceles. So then, so I'll expecting a scalene, then so not a valid input parameter list. These are the some expected output result. So these set of input parameter list, I will going to give the code, and then I will check the, I will going to test that code. Whenever, that is what we are calling it as a exercising the software by specifying a different test cases, either like by using a boundary value analysis method, or else by using a equivalence class partitioning method. So we will going to test that particular code, that we are calling it as a exercising the software. So a test has a two goals basically. So first one is, so to find the failure, and the second one is to demonstrate the correct execution. Means the basic goal or idea of this particular test is, two goals are there. One is to identify the failures, and the second one is to demonstrate the execution or correct execution of the program. So these are the based on these two goals. So we are exercising that software by specifying the different set of input parameter list, by specifying different set of input parameter list for a given program. This is about the definition of your fifth, that is test. The next definition is test cases. What is the meaning of test cases? So how to define this test cases and how we are using these test cases for a in the software testing program. The test cases has an identity and is associated with the program behavior. Okay, based on the program behavior, so we are going to give the input parameter list that are all associated with based on the program behavior. So means test cases also have a some set of input parameter list and as well as expected output result. Based on the set of input parameter list and expected output result, the program behavior needs to be depend on the input and as well as output. Means what set of input parameter list we are passing to the program and what is our expected output result. Based on that, it has to identify and it needs to associate it with the program behavior based on these two parameter list. Okay, that is what we can call it as a test cases. So this is a definition of so test case. So next is, so we'll move to the test life cycle. How basically a test life cycle will be. So for example, in the last video lecturing, so we have learnt about the V model of the software engineering, where we have seen that SDLC life cycle, that is software development life cycle, along with the software testing life cycle. So where it includes the requirement specification, so then implementation of the coding, high level implementation and low level implementation, and then testing. Similarly, so that is right side of the V model, and in the left side of the V model, we have seen that the different set of test cases like unit testing, integration testing and as well as system testing. The same testing life cycle I can display here. This particular figure will going to give a clear picture about the test life cycle. So that is STLC, in short form we can call it as software testing life cycle. How we will going to test a given product or a software. This life cycle or this particular diagram can be summarized. Basically there are right side three phases are there, that is requirement specification, design and coding. In these first three phases, we are putting the bugs into the code. We are putting the bugs into the code means there might be a chances of errors which are existed in these phases. Okay, so still if you are executing, then the fault will be the output result. So you can see here, so this is the fault. So after, if you are still errors are there, then if you are executing the requirement specification, then we are getting the fault output result, correct? This fault output result will be acts as an input parameter list for this design. Then some other errors will also existed, or else bugs are getting into this phase, that is design phase. Once again, by using these two input parameter list, whatever the resultant output result we are getting from the designing part, that is also a fault included output result. When fault included input are coming to the coding, based on this input only they will go and write the coding part. Once they are writing the coding part, they will going to do the mistake. That mistakes we are calling it as a errors. Once errors are existed in this coding part, both together, this error and as well as fault, will give the output result once again a fault, not a free error, faulty errors. Okay, means then the testing will picture will be coming into picture. Now these three phases are there. These three phases are we can call it as a finding the bug phases, or we can also call it as, so we will going to identify the bugs. Okay, under these phases, that is fault classification, fault isolation phase and fault resolution phase. So here, so first we'll going to identify the what type of faults are existed, and based on that we will do the classification, whether it is a
designing for failure or requirement specification failure or coding failure based on by specifying some set of input and as well as output result. We will going to cross verify whether so what type of errors are there and what type of error. So that classification we are fault classification we are doing under this phase. After finding this, so we will going to removing those bugs. That is after identifying, then fault isolation will be there. Then fault isolation, once again it will trying to remove those bugs. Okay, so we are removing those bugs. That is nothing but we can call it as a bug out. Okay, bugs are out. So in the third phase, that is fault resolution is there. So it is another opportunity where so the errors can be added or new errors can be entered into this phase, and we have to take care of those errors also, and then we need to fix the errors. This is the what we can call it as a testing life cycle or a process. Is that clear? I think it's clear to all of you. In the right side path, this is total, this path is there, that we can call it as a software development life cycle. Okay, so this particular path is there. So this path I can in short form I can call it as STLC, software testing life cycle. So total together I can call it as a testing life cycle, means so combination of SDLC plus STLC. So I can call it as total, it is testing life cycle, testing life cycle. Okay, so where the bugs are getting into this phases, and then we are writing the test cases, and to we are identifying those bugs. After identifying, we will fix that bugs, or else we are trying to remove those bugs from that these three phases. And there is a chances of getting once again some other type set of errors in the fault resolution also. So that also we need to take care. So during the STLC life cycle. So now there is one more point is there in under this STLC life cycle. The process of testing, which is also can be subdivided into separate steps. So these are the testing concepts are there. That is fault classification, fault isolation or fault resolution. So that also we can make it in the STLC life cycle manner, or process of testing can be subdivided or separate steps we can make it. That I am going to give a clear detail about now. So how we can split it, testing life cycle. The testing life cycle we can split it in this format. So there is a test planning, test case development, running the test cases and evaluating the test results. These are the. Now I will explain about the process of testing, means so that STLC life cycle, once again it is subdivided into separate steps. So how the process will be undergoing, that is testing process. There are basically, I told already, the four phases are there. In the four phases, so the process of testing will be undergoing. The first step is about the test planning. Test planning. And the second step is test case development. Test case development. And the third step is running those test cases. Test cases. And the last process is evaluating those test results. Evaluating test results means whichever the test cases we have written, those results we have to evaluate. For example, here, so for first we will collect the requirement specifications from the user. Based on the requirement specification, we will do the designing specification. So and so then we will start to implementing those designing specifications. Okay, and after that, so we will going to write the test cases. Similarly, so in the STLC life cycle, so first we will plan, so what type of test cases or what type of testing method we need to apply for the given problem based on the user problem or user requirement specification. So we will going to plan what type of test cases we have to apply, whether we have to apply the functional test cases or non-functional test cases. Either I can say that black box testing or white box testing, or whether it is required both black box and as well as white box. In that, what type of testing technique I need to apply, whether I have to apply a boundary value analysis method or else whether I need to apply a equivalent class partitioning method, or whether I need to apply a decision table technique, or whether I need to go for a data flow testing technique. Okay, means there are different testing techniques are there. That, so initially we will going to plan. That is what we can call it as a test planning, based on the requirement specification of the user, based on the designing specification, based on the implementation. So we will going to decide what type of test cases we have to write, what are all the test cases we need to implement, and what are the tool we need to use and what technique we have to use it. And then based on that, we will write the test cases, means test case development. For example, if it is a triangle problem, then we will give the three sides of a triangle. Let us consider A, B, C are the three sides of a triangle. Then, for example, let us consider 1 to 10 is the minimum and maximum range of the sides of a triangle. Then, so we need to specify the values between 1 to 10 itself only. If you are specifying more than that or less than that, less than the given value, then so it has to throw the error for the user. Okay, or else it has to report it to the user. Kindly specify the values between 1 to 10 itself only. Like that. So we will generate the test cases, we will going to design the test cases, and after that we will run that test cases. That is nothing but, for example, let us consider if I am giving a 1 1 1, so then what will be my expected output result? So when I am giving a 1 2 2, then what expected output result I need to get? So if I am giving 2 1 2, then what will be the output result? When I am giving 10 10 10, so what is my expected output result? Means, so these are the some set of input parameter list we are specifying for a given program, and then we are expecting some expected output results are there. So whether we are getting expected output result or not, means, so we will going to run these test cases, these set of test cases for the given program, and then we will going to check the output result, whether we are getting a correct output result or not. No, this is the third step. So that is running the test cases. After running the test cases, then we will try to evaluate the output results. Means, what type of output result we are getting, whether we are getting a correct output result, what we are expecting, or whether we are getting a different set of output result. So that we have to check it, and then the bugs will be identifying, and that bug report will be given back to the designer or implementer. So once again to redesign where that bugs are existed in that particular code. Like that, the throughout process of testing will be undergoing in the STLC lifecycle. That is test planning, test case development, test running or else running the test cases, and last step is evaluating those test results. So this is about the testing lifecycle and as well as the process of testing. The next topic is software quality. The software quality is nothing but it is defined as a field of study and practice that describes the desirable attribute of software product. Means, so it is a field of study, okay, and as well as it is a practice that will going to describe the desirable attribute of the software product. Means there are some set of attributes are there. Based on those attributes, we are going to evaluate the product, whether that product is a good quality one or not. So that is based on the study and based on the practice, so that we can identify, or else based on the description of the those properties, we are going to identify whether the software quality is good or not. There are basically two main approaches are there for the software quality. First one is defect management, so that is to identify the defects in that particular product, and then second one is quality attribute. So these are the two approaches to identify the software quality. One is we have to identify the defects in that particular product or else in that software, and then second one is we have to check the different set of quality attributes in that particular product. So what is meant by a defect management, and what are all the how to identify the defect in that particular product? So a software defect can be regarded as any failure to address to the end user requirement. For example, so the whenever the product will be ready and we will going to launch that product to the market, then the user will be using that product. Okay, once the user will use that product, user will come to know that these are the some of the functionalities which are not works properly, either a hardware failure or a software failure, that will be identified and then that will be addressed so by the end user. Okay, means based on the end user requirement, if the software is not works, then the defects are identified according to the end user requirement specification. If it is not satisfying the end user requirement, so for example, some common defects are there which are included missed or misunderstood requirement. For example, whenever we are collecting the requirement specification from the end user, we have to collect it those requirements is very clearly or in a specific manner, and so there should not be any misunderstanding or else missed information whenever we are collecting the information from the end user. Once we are collecting those information properly, then so it is error free. Else what happens? So based on the misunderstood requirement or missed information, so what we'll do means we'll going to design. Okay, means next phase will go executes. So based on the requirement specification only, the designing specification will be done. In that case, errors in designing of obviously whatever the requirement we have collected, that is all missed information or misunderstood information. So for that misunderstood information we are designing, that is errors will be there. So then functional logic will be wrong, data relationships are there, that will also becomes wrong in between, and process timing is there, that is a waste of processing time, and validation checking, coding errors, these are all we can call it as a some of the defect management team, where they'll going to check these are all the things, whether all the requirement specifications are correct or not, whether the design is included any errors or not, whatever the functional logic they have written, whether that functional logic is works properly or not, whatever the data relationship between the two models are there or relationships are there, whether it is correct or wrong, and then so what is the process timing, so to execute that particular code, that process timing and as well as validating, checking and coding errors, that are all identified under this. So defect management, that is a one of the software quality team, or else it is a part of the software quality, where this is the one working principle where defect management will be going to identify the software quality. Then second one is, I told we are talking about the quality attributes. So the quality attributes, this approach, so the software quality is best exemplified by fixed quality model. Like there are some of the Indian standard organizations are there, they'll going to check our product whether it is a met the requirement specification or else whether it is met the all the ISO standards or not. If these standards are described a hierarchy of a 8 quality characteristics, those 8 quality characteristics needs to be satisfied. If and only if all the quality characteristics are satisfied, then ISO will going to give the standard for the product. Okay, that is, so what are all the characteristics are included or quality characteristics to check the quality means? One is functional suitability, what is requirement is there according to the requirement, so that product has been developed or designed or not. Then reliability of that particular product, and then operability, that is nothing but whenever user will be using that product, so he has to use that product very comfortable manner and easy manner, so whether it is satisfying that or not. Then the performance efficiency will going to test under the, so under this quality attribute, it is also one quality attribute, whether it is compared to other product, whether your performance of your product is good or not. Then security wise, we will going to check whether your product is specified with the security or not, means secured or not then the compatibility and then maintainability. So these are the, and last one is transferability. So these are these 8 quality attributes are there. If these 8 sub characteristics are satisfied, then ISO will going to give the quality attribute seal for our product. Means then you can produce that product to the market once these are all the characteristics are satisfied. So apart from that, there are two main software quality attributes are there. One is static quality attribute and dynamic quality attribute. So which we have discussed, that eight quality characteristics are there, that are all comes under this these two quality attributes, like static quality attribute and as well as dynamic quality attribute. The static quality attributes are structured, maintainable, testable code, as well as the availability of the correct and complete documentation can be available for this static quality attributes. But whereas in the dynamic quality attributes, which is related to a software reliability and correctness of the software and completeness of the software and consistency of that particular product and usability of that particular product and as well as the performance of that particular product, these kind of characteristics we are segregated into dynamic quality attributes and as well as static quality attributes. These are the attribute manner or quality attribute manner we have splitted, which are comes under the static quality, which characteristics are comes under the dynamic quality attributes. This is about the software quality. So now the next topic is test cases. What is meant by a test cases? So basically, so we have seen the definition of the test cases. So in the first slide, so where, what is meant by a test case, so what are all the things it has been included in the test cases, that detailed description we will going to learn now. The test case is nothing but it has an identity and also it is associated with the program behavior, what I told already. There are some set of input parameter list will be there, then expected output results will be there under the test cases. So similarly, the essence of software testing is to determine a set of test cases for an item to be tested. Means it includes the number of test cases. So for the product, which one we want to test. So for that, it is so included the number of test cases. Means to determine the set of test cases for a given item need to be tested. So those we can call it as a software testing. So before going on, we need to clarify what information should be in a test cases. Means what are all the information do you want to include it in the test cases. That information you should have a very clear idea. So the test case should contain the following information. So what are all the informations are included under the test cases. So please, under the test cases, so the following informations are included. The first one is input, that is nothing but what are all the different set of inputs you are going to specify for your code. That information need to be there in the test cases. That is, there are basically two types of inputs are there. First one is preconditions and the second one is actual inputs. The preconditions are nothing but these are the some of the circumstances that hold prior to test case execution. Means before executing the test cases, what are all the preconditions needs to be satisfied? That is what we can call it as a prior to the test case execution. So we need to set the circumstances. So based on within that given circumstances, so we have to execute our test cases. Then actual input. The actual inputs are nothing but these are identified by some testing method. Means for example, if whether you are using a boundary value analysis method, or whether you are using a equivalence class partitioning method, or whether you are using a data flow method or else basis part testing method. So what type of testing method you are applying or you are using, based on that actual input parameter list will be depends. Okay, these are the information about the inputs. And next, second what I told, so based on the set of input and based on the expected output results. So next, second one is expected output. So expected output, once again, it is also split into two output results. One is post conditions and second one is actual outputs. The post conditions are nothing but what are all the condition we need to set after executing that particular part or a model. That is what we have to set some condition. That is what we will call it as a post conditions. Actual outputs are nothing but what is your expectation. For example, I told initially, if you are writing a triangle problem, while writing a triangle problem, if you specified a like a 10, 10, 10 as a three inputs of a three sides of a triangle, then my output result will be a equilateral triangle. Okay, so my expected output result is equilateral triangle. So in case if I am getting a correct output result, then there is no any bugs in that particular code. Okay, else if you are getting a different output result instead of equilateral, if you are getting a isosceles or else a scalene or else it is not, cannot form a triangle at all. Okay, in that case we can call it as a, so bugs are existed in that particular given code. This is the second test case contains the information. That is, first information about the input, second information is about the expected output result. And the third one is, before going with the third one, so the third I can call it as, the test case should have an identity and a reason for being. That is nothing but, so requirement tracing is a fine reason. For example, why we are we need to specify the identity for a test cases and what is the reason behind for that tracing it. Well, for example, when we are testing, if a thousand or lakhs together lines of code, then it's very difficult to identify in which line the errors are existed or for which line we are writing the test cases or for which test case is having a bugs. When we are giving a set of inputs and expected output result, if it is wrong, then it's very difficult to me to identify which test case is failure. Correct. So to identify that one, we should have an identity and as well as reason for being. That is nothing but requirement tracing is a fine reason. Correct. So therefore, so we required a identity for example, so if I am writing a test case like a first test case, so I want to check input is 10, 10, 10 for a given triangle problem where A is a side, B is also one more side and C is also one more side of a triangle. Then my these are the set of inputs. This is the test case 1 and my expected output result is equilateral triangle. Then actual output result I will going to get after executing. So if it is also equilateral, then the test case will be a pass. Correct. So next, second test case, when I am giving 1, 2, 3 as an input, then what is my expected output result and what is actual output result, whether test case is pass or fail. Means if you are specifying these 1, 2, 3, 4 numbers, these are all we can call it as an identity. Means to identify which test case is failed. Like here I have written pass, if it is here it is fail, then to identify this is the third test case is failed when we will give these three input parameter list for the program. Means to identify that, so we need to specify the identity number and as well as reason for being to have an identity number. Then the fourth requirement or else in the test cases it includes means the history of the test cases. History of the test cases. So that is, history is nothing but when including, it includes that history is nothing but when it is executed, by whom it is executed or else it has been written. So and then how many number of pass and fail results are existed in that particular test case report, and which version or a software so they have used or else they have run. So that are all the informations are included under the history of the test cases. Okay, so this is the fourth point. These are all the informations where need to be included in the given test case report. And apart from that, so there are these kind of information can also be existed. That is, so I told test case ID should be there, then purpose of the test case ID, why we have written the test cases, that purpose needs to be mentioned very clearly. Then there should be a preconditions, so for which, for the inputs, okay, and there should be some expected output result, and then there should be a post conditions for that. and then so execution history. What I told, this is the point 1 and this is the point 2, this is the point 3 and this is the point 4, what I have discussed till now. Means execution history, what are all the things it is included? It is included about the date, means when it is executed, on which date it is executed, what was the result and which version of the tool they have used and run by whom. Okay, that information. So this total test cases are included. Okay, this is about your test cases and what are all the information need to be there in the test cases. Now the last point about the test cases is, test cases need to be developed, test cases need to be reviewed, and test cases need to be used, and test cases need to be managed, and it has to be get saved in the documentation. Means, so I told, we have to develop the test cases and then we have to review those test cases, whether pass or failed, then we have to use it with the different programming specifications and to test that programs, and then we have to manage those test cases and as well as test report. After executing, we are getting output result, when it is tested, date, time, and as well as tool which you have used, on which software you have tested that, and by whom it is tested, and as well as that needs to be saved. This is a very important with related to a test cases. Now we will discuss about the topic, that is insight from a Venn diagram. So why we need this Venn diagram for a software testing? How to draw a Venn diagram in the software testing? How it is helpful to do the analysis of the software testing? Okay, that we will learn. So basically the testing is concerned with the behavior of a program, and as well as always that behavior should be orthogonal in nature to the structural view. That is, it is common to us software developers. So I'll explain in detail with the Venn diagram how this will be related together. The structural view will be focusing on what it is, and the behavioral view will be considered what it does. Okay, so these are the basic two ideas, that is structural view and as well as behavioral view. So here there is a one simple Venn diagram that will going to clarify several nagging questions about the testing. I will explain with an diagram. You can see here, so there is a one diagram I will draw here. You can see Venn diagram. So this is orthogonal. Okay, so let us consider this is the specification. Okay, so specification is nothing but, you can also call it as expected. What a end user is specified, he will be expecting this output result. Okay, now the programmer is there. This is the programmer. You can see here, I'll write here, this part is program. That is nothing but, it has been observed by the designer. Okay, in short form, specification will be specified by using a S, the program will be specified by using a P. Okay, now you can see here, so the program behavior and as well as specification behaviors are in the circle which has been labeled by S, and all those behavior actually programmed are in P. Okay, for example, now you can see the intersection of S and P is the correct portion. You can see here, this is the correct portion where it has been specified and as well as it has been programmed. Okay, so those behavior, that is behaviors that are both specified and as well as implemented, you can call this as. With this diagram, it is seen more clearly that problems faced by the tester. For example, if the tester will going to write the test cases based on the specification behavior or based on the program behavior, then what happens? Okay, so now if the programmer will going to write the tester will going to write the code and he will going to test in this circle manner. I think it is visible. Okay, now so I will call it as a tested. Okay, the programmer is written a program based on the user requirement specification. Now the tester has been tested both specification behavior and as well as program behavior. Now you can see I'll going to give the numbers for these reasons. Okay, so let us consider this is the reason 1. Okay, now this is the reason 2. Now this is might be a reason let us 3. Okay, this one is the 4, this one is the 5, and I can call it as this one is the 6, and this one will be the 7. Okay, now this is the test case. I can call it as this is the test case where it is verified. I can call verified. Okay, this is the first one is specification behavior. Second one is program behavior. And the third one is test cases. Okay, so now see, the specification behavior is nothing but what? User requirement specification. The program behavior is nothing but what? Developer. So he has developed based on this specification, correct? Then after getting these two information, the tester will going to write the test cases. Okay, that is what test behavior or tested behavior. These are the three things which are showing in this particular figure. So what is the what this diagram will going to explain? It is seen more clearly the problems faced by the tester. Okay, means so you can see here which are all the problem has been faced by the tester. If certain specified behaviors have not been programmed, okay, there is a fault of omission. For example, you can see this area, I will generally make change the color. This area is there, no? This area, this particular area, which is what I can call it as fault of omission. You know the meaning of fault of omission. Omission is nothing but the developer which is not at all developed a code which has been specified by the user. Okay, so means he left that particular part which is not at all coded, then which is not at all coded, which cannot be tested by the tester. Yes or no? Therefore, he will be facing the problem. That is the first problem. What if certain programmed behavior have not been specified? Okay. So these are the, we can call it as corresponds to fault of commission. Fault of commission is nothing but where which is not at all specified, still also you have programmed. Okay, for example, so this is the portion, I'll write it here. So this is the portion is there. This portion, which is not at all specified by the user, but still also you have written a code that is program behavior. So this is what I can call it as fault of commission. I think now you get the clear idea about the what is meant by fault of omission and fault of omission. Now see, the programmer is there. He is programmed for the specification of the user. What he has specified, for that he has been developed some code. While developing that code, so he has developed, so this particular portion is there. He has left it out, this portion. So then only this much portion he has covered under the coding. Then remaining coding he has written, that code is not at all useful for the user, which has according to the specification behavior. Therefore, that coding part we can call it as fault of commission. Which part he has not at all coded, then that part I can call it as fault of omission. Means, so he has not at all considered that specification. So from this part, so therefore this diagram in short form we will call it as SPT, that is specification, programmed and tested relationship among the three sets. Okay, so a view of testing is that it is the determination of the extension of the program behavior, that is both specified and as well as implemented. Now you can see from this particular diagram, so where the tester has been tested, some of the part, that is nothing but you can see the three portion is there, number three, you can see this is the portion. So he has written a code for this portion, but which is not specified by the user, still also we are tested, correct? So therefore it is a wasting of time and wasting of totally it is fault of commission, I can call it as a word. There may be a specified behavior that are not tested, that portion I can call it as that is portion 2 and portion number 5 are there. These two are not at all tested by the tester, not tested by the tester, correct? So then specified behaviors that are tested, that is only reason 1 and 4 are tested. You can see here reason 1 and 4 are tested by the tester. Okay, so then so unspecified behaviors are there in the reason 3 and 7. You can see reason 3 and 7 are there. These are all unspecified by the user. Still we have written a test cases for the these two reasons. Then this is the wasting of time. So why? Because the properly the specification has been not understood by the tester and as well as designer. Still also they are writing the test cases and as well as they are developing the code for that. Okay, now there may be a programmed behavior. When I'll talk with respect to the program behavior, you can see here. So there is a reason 2 and 6 is there. He has written a code for this reason. This 2 and 6 reasons are not at all tested by the tester. Yes or no? Yes. So the programmed behavior that are tested by the tester, that is a reason, which one? That is a reason 1 and 3. So these are all tested by the tester. This is not tested by the tester. And test cases that corresponds to unprogrammed behaviors are there. See here, the reason number 4 and reason number 7, these are all not at all programmed. Still also we are writing the test cases for that. Therefore, so you can see what is expected where you are testing, which is not required, that is unprogrammed areas are there. That unprogrammed areas are also you are tested. So therefore this total figure will give the clear picture what is user is expecting. So what the programmer is programmed in, which area or which particular portion he has covered and which particular portion he is not at all covered. So and a tester in which area he has covered with respect to the specification behavior and as well as program behavior. So that will give the clear picture. So if specified behavior exists for which no test cases are available, then testing is incomplete. If certain test cases corresponds to unspecified behavior, then either such test cases are unwanted or else warranted, the specification is deficient, or tester wishes to determine that specified non-behavior does not occur over here. Therefore, so you can have an idea by seeing this figure. So what the tester needs to do and what the programmer has to do, means based on the specification, the programmer has to write the programmable part and he has to cover maximum part of the specification. And then the similarly, that tester has to write the test cases based on the specification behavior and as well as program behavior, he has to cover a maximum part. For example, at the end, what type of figure we want, you can see here, this is the specification behavior. Let us consider this is the yes. Then the programmer will going to write the code, then he will going to cover this much area, by writing this code, then I can call it as this is the program behavior. Similarly, the tester will going to write the test cases, then he will going to cover this much area. This is the testing area. Now, maybe the 10% or 15% which is not at all programmed, then it is fine. So then the tester is not at all tested this 10 to 15% of the total whole program, then it is fine. Means the testing can be applicable not 100%, maximum 80 to 90% of programmable part can be tested under the software testing. So therefore, so please remember 80 to 90% programmable code can be tested by the tester means approximately we are reaching 100%. So therefore, so always the programmer, tester and specification behavior needs to met. So with respect to the what are all the requirement specifications are there based on the requirement specification. This is about the diagram of the Venn diagram, how it looks and what are all the areas are covered by the tester, by the programmer and as well as so what specification has been defined by the end users. Okay, so this is about the Venn diagram explanation of the software testing, how we are using the Venn diagram under the software testing. Thank you. Hope it's clear to all of you. Please like the video, share the video, and as well as subscribe the channel.